Nice to meet you. So I'm my name is Jean-Paul Chauvet, and I'm the president of a company called Lightspeed. We do a number of things. We have a retail point of sale, a restaurant point of sale, and we also have an e-commerce platform. So I'm happy to be here. I was here last year, and I talked about jeans, and but this year I'm going to talk about bikes. And I think really what I want to try and do today is give you a really high-level view of what we think the challenges are for omnichannel, and really look at how we think retailers and how our typical customers should be working with omnichannel and embracing it to improve the experience. So maybe before we start, who in this room has an e-commerce platform? Okay, who has a retail platform? So a retail store. Anyone has a retail store in the room? Okay. So I think maybe just talking about Lightspeed, our mission is really, we say we're here to save cities. I know it's kind of a crazy mission, but what do we mean by saving cities? Really, we think that if you don't have enough technology for the small independent business people and retailers and online presences, if you don't have anyone to provide these people technology, you'll end up with cities that have only big retailers. And what we think makes the difference between cities is really retail stores and restaurants, and that's what makes the experience inside of a city. And since day one, our mission at Lightspeed is really to provide technologies to small independent businesses so that they can compete against the big guys. And at the end of all of this, we really call it saving cities, because we want to be sure that, you know, when you go to Bangkok, or if you go to Paris, or if you go to London, or if you go to Amsterdam, we know that what makes the differences between cities are these small retail and small restaurant owners who actually make a difference and create an experience inside of the cities. And so that's why we're very excited to be at this show, and that's why we believe in e-commerce also. Because, you know, if you look at retail, or if you look at restaurants at the time, maybe 10 years ago, people who had an idea, the first thing they would do, they would create the idea and open a retail store. And we think that today what's happening is a lot of people are going to open retail stores, but also a lot of people are going to open an online store and an online presence, and from there are going to grow, and at some point are also going to start doing physical presences as their online becomes successful. So I'm just going to start with an example, and I think that'll give you an idea of how we see evolving the typical buyer and how this has an impact on omnichannel and what does it really mean for people. So I decided to become healthy last summer, and I was like, I'm going to buy an electric bike. And so the first thing you do when you want to buy an item, or you want to learn about an item, is you go online and you search. And in my case, I wanted a high-performance electric bike. And after a lot of research online, I found out that I wanted a Solex. And I don't know if you know what the brand, the Solex, it's a very old French motorbike, and after-war motorbike, and you would ignite the engine by just turning it onto the wheel, and it would make the bike go forward. And what I found out doing research online is that Solex, which is a very old French brand, actually developed a bike, which was an electric bike, and it was designed by Pininfarina, who's a very famous designer, and I was like, okay, that's the bike I want. And once I did my research online, I went to the Solex web store, and the next thing I do is, I live in Montreal, I'm Canadian, and I was like, okay, I want to buy a Solex in Montreal. And from there, I basically landed an online store, and this online store had a good omnichannel capability where it enabled me from the online store to reserve the bike that I wanted, so I could go into the store and pick up the bike. So then I went to the store, and even though my first experience was online and I searched online, I ended up in a store where I tried the bike, tested the bike, bought the bike, and I also bought a few accessories. As I bought the bike, the store got my information from the online store, so they had my email address, they had my credit card, and I just had to confirm my purchase online. 3 months later, because it's an electric bike, it needs a bit of maintenance, so I receive an automatic email from the store where I bought the bike. I go into the store, I repair the bike. And for me, and there's a nice picture of the bike and me with my happy bike, but that's omnichannel. And for us, what it means is that regardless of where you come from, regardless of how you discover the store, what's important is that you can purchase online, you can reserve online, and you can bridge the two worlds and provide a great experience for the consumer. Now, that's all good, but this is the reality of the story. Is I live in the city center in Montreal, and 3 months later, as I'm browsing through the city with my bike, I realized there's a bike store 300 meters from where I live that had that bike. And here, if you actually look at the net result, if I knew that there was a store next to where I live that had the bike, I would have bought the bike there. And the net result for the retailer is they did not have an online presence, they did not expose their inventory online, and the end story is they lost a sale, which I would have done. And I think that's, unfortunately, a very good example of what omnichannel means nowadays. And I think it's a good example of how people purchase nowadays. And you know, Lightspeed, our primary focus is really, we started working with physical retailers. And unfortunately, I talk to a lot of physical retailers, and every time I ask them, do you have an online presence? What they answer is, no, we don't have time. That's a big answer. Or no, we don't do it because only 5% of our sales come online. And I think that's the first misperception. And at Lightspeed, we work quite a bit with Google, and I can maybe talk about the projects we're doing with them. But that's the big misperception is, today, the days of anyone walking through the city and browsing through a store and browsing through a main street and stopping at a store and, you know, discovering a store and going in and buying, those days are counted now and they don't really exist anymore. The reality is people, before they purchase, they know exactly what they're going to purchase. And the reality is an online presence doesn't drive online sales. It drives physical traffic to your store. And maybe talking about Google, all of the big guys right now, and I can't talk completely about what we're doing, but all the big guys are very cognizant that now all of the online strategies that were applied to the online world, which is driving traffic to a website, measuring conversion, and from there measuring a basket and measuring your cost of acquisition versus your lifetime value of your customer, all of that is now going to hit the physical retail. And if you look at all the big players, they're actually looking at now how they can sell a lot of online ads and how they can prove that the online advertising converts inside of a store at what value. So what you see as you go forward, you're going to see the two worlds bridging together, and you're going to see a lot of the strategies that are purely online strategies go into physical stores around, I'm driving the traffic, how many people have entered the store, how many people have converted in the store, what was my cost of traffic versus my profits on my store. And we'll see more and more of this as we go forward. So here are a few numbers, and I think they're interesting. The first one, so I don't know if you heard about web rooming and showrooming. Showrooming was a concept about 5-6 years ago, and I don't know if you followed it, but a lot of people were, you know, when a lot of the sales were starting to go online, you had a lot of stores that were putting signs and saying, hey, you're not permitted to enter the store with a device, or in the US, you can't browse in store while you're, because everyone was worried about web rooming. And web rooming was a concept of, I go into a store, I use my store to learn about the item and learn about the product, and I end up buying the item online. And everyone was really confused about the fact that, oh my God, web rooming, and it's the end of physical retail, and it's the end of people buying in stores, and people are just using stores as a showroom, and then they end up buying online. Well, actually, that's not what happened. What happened is the actual opposite, is web rooming. And that's what I talked about with my bike, is what happened now is people are now searching online before they enter, they end up in the store. And I think the real question is, why do people end up in the store? Unfortunately, because the brand narrative and the experience inside of a store can never be matched on an e-commerce. And it's been proven with a number of research is that retention of customers, and if you look at the real experience of a shopper, the brand association is always going to be stronger in a physical environment. And that's an example, you know, if you look at Apple, I think is the perfect example of that, is even though they sell exactly the same items, they're all serialized, they've created an experience in store that is so strong that people could buy online, but they would rather go to an Apple store to buy. And that's, again, all of this logic around the brand narrative inside. So what have we seen, and what are we going to start seeing with this 87% of web rooming? You're going to see more and more physical stores have a very strong online presence, because they're going to use the online presence to attract the people to the store. And then actually the other big thing that's going to happen is the follow-up purchase. Once you've associated yourself to a brand, your follow-up purchases are often made online. And you'll see more and more of that. The other thing you're going to see more and more, and I know now it's kind of become mainstream, is you'll have a lot of the pure online players that are now going to start developing physical brick and mortars. And I know of a number, I mean, the biggest is Amazon now, who are starting to open more and more stores. And they use it for two reasons, for the experience, but they also use it as a warehouse. And I don't know, in Canada, there's a company called Frank and Oak, which was a huge online retailer in North America. And now their strategy, their whole strategy is going to be around developing hundreds and hundreds of physical stores. The other thing you're going to see happening if you're a pure e-commerce player is the cost of acquisition online has become prohibitive. And what people are realizing is that actually acquiring traffic in a physical world, when you just have to pay, you just have to pay your store, is often less expensive, depending on where you're doing your store, than now acquiring the online traffic if you're in a segment that has a lot of competition. So at the end of all of this, what I'm just trying to tell you today and trying to bring to you is the fact that omnichannel is going to be the new way of going. And it's about going from one world to the next and making it completely transparent and invisible for the user. Couple of other things. 82%. When you're about to buy in store and your salesperson pitches a product in store, 82% of people just before buying are going to go online to review the items and be sure that what they're about to buy is a good item. And I think the other one for this show that's pretty interesting is 33% of traffic out of e-commerce comes from mobile devices now. And here, maybe talking about omnichannel and talking about what's going to happen, if you look at all the big search engines, geolocation in the search engines has become more and more important. And you'll see more and more of geolocations that are going to point to physical stores that hold an inventory of what you're trying to buy. And in a specific neighborhood at the intersections of streets. And you'll see more and more about that. And we are actually doing a few tests with pretty big stores in North America where actually it's about geolocations on search engines, and it's about proving the conversion rates on purchases inside of a store. So what do we see on the market today? We see three kinds of retailers. The first type of retailer that we see is a retailer that doesn't have an online presence. And here, I think the education is to actually not talk about the online experience, but actually talk about how much you're losing in terms of your traffic inside of your store and how much you're losing in terms of revenues because you're not exposing that inventory online. And unfortunately here, there's the perception and the reality. The perception from the small retailers is that it's complex, it's difficult to manage, it's expensive, and it's only going to bring 5% more revenues, because that's what they point to, is that the statistics is 5% of retail is sold online. But that's completely wrong. The reality is you're losing way more revenues because you're not exposing the inventory online. I'll just give you a number. On average, a Lightspeed customer, once we've ignited omnichannel, grows their revenues by 20% in the first year. The second type of retailer that we see is they know they need an online presence. They're really focused on selling online and selling in store, but they have no integrations between the two worlds. And that means for them, there's a couple of things. That means they spend hours every day trying to reconsolidate on an Excel sheet the inventory from the online store and the offline store. Often what happens, the experience is pretty poor because you might have a customer that's a really good online customer. When he comes to the store, you don't even recognize him because they don't merge. They don't merge the consumers, they don't merge the inventory, they don't merge the data. And all they can do is basically go as far as they can, but there's a lot of manual processes, and actually the experience is pretty poor for the user. And finally, what we see is the third type of retailer is they do have an online presence, they do have an offline presence, and they have a beginning of an integration. And by beginning of an integration, normally what we see is they will merge one thing. They will merge the customers, or they'll merge the inventory, or they will merge maybe the data. They'll have a consolidated view in an Excel sheet of who sells what where. But unfortunately, as long as you have two solutions, what we've realized, and we used to have that because we had two solutions when we started exploring how can we help, because we come from physical retail, but how can we help our physical retailers go online? And we started at the beginning by doing integrations with with e-commerce. We were integrated with, you know, the big guys, the Magentos, integrated with Shopify, integrated with BigCommerce. And obviously we were North American, so we didn't know about SEO Shop at the time. But and what we realized is that you cannot go deep enough. You will never go deep enough to make the experience good. Because at the end of the day, if you want the experience to be amazing for the consumer, it's not about synchronizing and bringing data from one system to the next. It's actually around understanding the consumer, building all of your marketing around the consumer and understanding the consumer and how they consume. It's all about integrating the inventory. And that's a big piece of what makes a retailer online or offline successful, is understanding your inventory, understanding what sells well, understanding what consumer buys what when, and understanding what strategies you need to do. And so at the end of the day, that third segment is maybe more advanced than the two others. But what we realized at Lightspeed, and as you know, we merged with SEO Shop about 18 months ago. And what we've been doing for 18 months is we call it no compromise. We've been trying to merge together the two platforms. So we've merged the customers, we've merged the inventory, we've merged the analytics and the data. And so what we have today is one integrated platform that enables anyone, if you're online, to ignite very easily a physical store with the same inventory, and vice versa, is if I have a physical presence, to just say, hey, I'm going to go online, here's my theme, off you go, and from there you can define what items you want to synchronize online and what you want to start selling online. We also have the logic of an integrated inventory management, so you have your items, your pictures, your images, your metadata, your pricing, all of that is in one, and from there you can have cross-channel. And finally, the last piece that we think is important is customers. We actually can see the whole history of purchase regardless of where it is. If your customer is a good online retailer, and a customer and goes to the store, you will see all of the history of purchase, and we can even get to you and say, hey, these are items we think this person can purchase. So we've put a lot of energy in this because we think, going back to our mission, this is what's going to save cities, and this is what's going to enable entrepreneurs to actually be able to compete with the big guys, is by packaging a lot of technology at a small price that we can make available to as many people as possible. So I'm going to finish with three concepts and try and see how can omnichannel help an online or an offline retailer do more. I think the first one is really about sales and marketing. It is going to drive your sales and marketing. So I know a lot of people said they were online and a lot of people said they were offline. If you actually take an integrated approach to those worlds, you will drive sales. You will drive sales because the experience is going to be great. You will enable anyone from anywhere to actually see your inventory. Anyone from anywhere identify, as I did with my bike, what store holds what I'm looking at purchasing. When you talk about marketing, you need to talk about re-engaging. There's a wonderful brand called Suit Supply, which is, I'm sure you know them, they're a Dutch brand. I'm a great fan of that brand. But actually, if you look at how Suit Supply work, I think it's amazing. And I don't know if you've ever gone through the entire experience. I'm a shopper, I'm a shopaholic, I must say. But anyway, I discovered that brand in New York. They opened the store. You go to the store, and the experience inside of a store is ultra curated. They help you, they put together all the accessories and the items that should be bought together. You have a really good experience with the salesperson, they know about the materials, they can do some custom fit as you get into the store. They actually take your credit card when you go to the store, they ask you for your email information, they ask you for information about yourself, and you don't realize what they're gonna do with this. But they actually vault your credit card. They actually know your size, they know exactly what items you bought, and they know what brands you like within their store. And then from that moment on, all of the re-engagement I've ever done with Suit Supply, I've never been to a store ever again. All of the re-engagement with me has been done purely online. Once every 2 weeks, I receive an email with everything I like. I click a button, they know exactly my size, they know what they hold, and they know. And they will do specials with me. They'll say, hey, we have a promotion on this type of shirt. We know you like it. And it's a fully integrated experience. I've never entered my credit card ever again. And I think, going back to why is omnichannel important for even a small, we can offer this kind of experience with a small brick and mortar. with an independent person that pays $89 a month. But why is it important, going back to omnichannel in terms of selling? We know that once you've associated yourself to a brand and you've associated yourself to a brand in a physical world, you now are trustworthy of the brand, you know the quality of the brand, the re-engagement strategies need to be online. And we've put a lot of energy in how do I enable my big marketing database, and how do I enable loyalty, and how do I analyze segments of my customer data to re-engage with my customers. And I think that's really important when you talk about omnichannel is really bridging the two worlds. We know that omnichannel will increase transaction sizes because of the history of purchase. You know what the people like, so we know it also increases the transaction sizes. And finally, when you talk about measuring the ROI, you can't just look at one world or look at the next. You can't just say, oh, is this a good customer? Because the reality is, and especially when you look now at the next generations, or if you look at the Generation X and Generation Y, these people we know are bridging the worlds in their life. And they will no longer just associate to a brand that only has a physical presence or an online presence. Second reason why you need to adopt omnichannel is really about the experience. And this is really about the long-term value of your brand. This is about knowing, how am I going to stay top of the mind of my consumers? It's by providing a great experience. How many times have you purchased online in a store and then went to the store and have this guy talk to you about the brand as if you didn't know anything about the brand? And that's unfortunate because people don't integrate the world right now. You still have 99% of the market that are siloed and 99% of the market that do not understand that it's different consumers. Before working at Lightspeed, I came from the media space. And the media space had exactly the same problem. You know, when newspapers and magazines started saying, oh no, the new people are gonna be, you know, the younger generation are gonna be looking online and the older generation are gonna be buying, you know, paper. It's proven now that it's the same people. Sometimes I want to look at a piece of paper, sometimes I want to look at a tablet, sometimes I want to go online and browse. And what happened at the beginning of the media is you had silos, and exactly, and I think we're still an early adopter now in understanding the behaviors of the consumers, but the same thing happened that is happening now, where people thought that it was different segments that purchased in different in the different mediums. And it's completely wrong. And now we're realizing, I think, in retail, that it's exactly the same segment. And what you see now in the market is the big guys like Suit Supply, like Gap, like they've understood this, they have the money. They can spend $2 million on an omnichannel platform, you know, working with all the best consultants. But our obsession at Lightspeed is really, how do I make this for the small entrepreneurs, for the small guys to compete against the big guys? How can I bring them the same technology to be sure that in 10 years from now, it's not just Starbucks and McDonald's and Gap and Suit Supply, even though I love that brand. The third reason why you need omnichannel, it's really the back office. And it's even more important, I think, this is really operational efficiencies. I spend my days talking to small online retailers or physical retailers, and what they tell me is they don't have time. They tell me that they have a passion, that they're passionate about whatever they sell, and that's what brought them there, and most of them have quit their day jobs to go and live their passion. And what they realized when they started going into that passion is that to compete and to make a dollar and to be competitive takes a lot of time, and they have no time. And that's also the big misperception, is it's going to be complex. But actually, if you look at omnichannel, it should save you a lot of time. It should save you all this manipulation, this all of the back office thing, trying to, I mean, we see all everything, but trying to manage your inventory from an Excel sheet to try and take customers who bought online and customers who bought offline, and then trying to create a pivot table around an email address to try and say, okay, who are the same customers? I mean, all of that takes a lot of time. And actually, if you work with a vendor that understands how to bridge the world, all of this will be fully automated, and you'll have a lot of efficiencies and gains in efficiencies in how you run your business. So that's what I have to say today. I'm going to finish with a video. I think at the end of the day, it's really the... we think the chasm has become bigger and bigger between the small guys and the big guys. And we want to democratize technology so that everyone in the world can actually be competitive and cities can remain cities. And the experience of a city is what makes you love a city. The experience of having a little coffee in Melbourne, Australia, and a coffee shop that curates their coffee like nobody else, or being in Amsterdam and looking at one of those, you know, wonderful little curated retails. That's what makes the experience of a city, and that's what we're after. We sell today in 100 countries. We have 40,000 customers around the world. I think we're one of the fastest growing companies in technology. We're hiring about 30 or 40 employees every month now. And we have our headquarters in Europe that are in Amsterdam. We have more than 100 people here. And we're actually opening a new headquarters in the coming months. And I don't, I think it's on Single Street, and it was the headquarters of the Socialist Party. And I thought, you know, having a North American company put their headquarters there was a fun thing. But it's a beautiful, beautiful building. I mean, and we're going to be relocating. We currently have 2 offices in Amsterdam, and we're going to be putting all of our people there, and we're going to be growing in this country because we believe in it. So I'm just going to finish with a video. It's an English customer, and it's them talking about how we've helped them and how we've enabled them to actually sell more and enable them to go from just physical to an omni-channel retailer.
Papillon is a home interior store based in Brighton, and our aim is to bring eclectic and interesting furniture to everyone.
And working with Lightspeed, we're looking at bringing the retail experience for the customer online.
The idea, the sensory experience of Papillon is really all about walking into your home.
We take a lot of care and attention, really curating a beautiful collection of items that you see in the store today.
We're using iPads an awful lot more in the store now, which has been a great tool for us to be able to sit with that customer and linking in and showing them exactly the different styles we can do for them. It's all there at our fingertips.
Omnichannel means delighting our customers, whether they come into the store or visit online.
What's really important for us as a business is that when we close our doors, we have the confidence that our web shop is providing the same service, the same look and the same quality that we would provide, you know, on a face-to-face with our customers. What we really needed here at Papillon was to have a system that was totally integrated into our point of sale system, and Lightspeed has delivered that for us. But integration with the Lightspeed in-store onto our web shop was so easy for us. We can have exactly the same products live on our website, and it's live stock as well, so if somebody buys something online, it takes it off of our main store here, which is perfect.
So given that Lightspeed is mobile and cloud-based, it means we've got 24-hour access anytime we want. Quick margin report, inventory checks.
The ability for us to be able to control our stock levels.
Lightspeed is fantastic because it's just so intuitive.
Lightspeed provide us with such a great different array of templates. They're all very design-led, and that's really important to us as a store, you know, who is very design-led ourselves.
When we found Lightspeed as a solution to our omnichannel requirements, it was like a breath of fresh air.
It's been a great asset, bringing in a lot more custom to Papillon. To be able to sell 24/7 for us, it's been a revelation.
I can say without reservation, it's actually exceeded our expectations in all areas.
Our whole concept now is our online and our in-store is seamless, and that's beautiful for us as a business.
So there's a big wide world out there, and we want to welcome everyone into Papillon.
And with Lightspeed Omnichannel, now we can.
So I don't know if you heard everything. I think the volume was a bit low, but these are typical customers of ours. We work in a number of industries, but we really try and make you know, all these small independent retailers or even the online e-commerce players, you know, enable bridging gaps and being more successful. So thank you very much. Very happy.